Hey guys, good morning. I hope you can hear me. Thanks for joining in today. So, the original plan that I had for this session, it has shifted a bit. So, as we were going through, like starting as beginners on learning what is big data, then what is Hadoop and MapReduce and etc. I was planning to show you now a practical lab on how to set up a multi-node Hadoop cluster on Linux, but that would take some time, okay, for me to set up the virtual machines and set up the lab for you guys. So I was busy with some other presentations, like for the last couple of weeks I was preparing for that, and that's why I just decided to go off the track a bit and redo one of the demos that I did in the Great Indian Developer Summit yesterday at IISc Bangalore. So I delivered two sessions. One, so both of them using Hadoop, okay, Microsoft's version of Hadoop or Microsoft's implementation of Hadoop, I should say. So both were done using that, using HDInsight. One was on cyber network log forensics, where you grab huge volume of server logs and even logs from your network devices, like routers and all. And you analyze the logs to see potential threats or to see if your servers are properly load balanced in terms of incoming requests and how the server serves the requests, and even nail down on what protocol is being used with a certain server for communication. So you can determine certain malicious activities as well on those servers. So one demo was on that, and the other one was social media sentiment analysis or opinion mining, as it is called. So it basically grabs some tweets focused on some specific keyword that the user needs to specify, or it will depend from business to business. And using again the Hadoop services, Hadoop Hive specifically, to parse that data and give you some idea on how people are talking or how people are reacting about a certain brand or a certain product or a certain movie for that matter. Okay, so that was the second session, and that's the one I want to redo here. So a couple of things that you need to understand is, so we all should have a basic idea now on Hadoop. I'm expecting that most of you have attended the other sessions. And if not, if you haven't attended the other sessions, I always encourage you to go ahead and see the videos, okay, that we have in the YouTube channel, okay, so that you can get up to the speed. Suddenly jumping in one of the calls is not going to help, okay. So what we have seen over the last couple of months, maybe since I started the calls with you guys, is what is big data, what is the present challenge, what is the business need. Data growing exponentially, volume, variety, blah blah, whatever. And then we see how Hadoop comes into the picture as a application which can tackle that much volume and variety, as well as the speed, the velocity. So it can tackle that part of that much of diversities in the data. And we see how we can set it up. What are the cores? What is the computing paradigm? What is the storage mechanism? We saw all these in detail. Now, if you come to the IT industry, you will see the reality in the market. Okay, so nobody is going to spend the time to learn, okay, and then set it up. So it doesn't work that way in a real life scenario. So a real life scenario will typically be, I have some data, I need some analysis, give it to me. So nobody is ready to spend that time these days, okay? Specifically, I'm saying these days because the industry is changing very fast. As you can see, the entire direction is towards cloud. Every giant in the software industry, you name it, like Google, Amazon, Microsoft, you really name it, and they are all into cloud. They are all into big data because that's the next thing that can serve the needs for many people, both from the technical part, from the innovation part, as well as from the survival or from the employment part. Okay, so things are going that way. So nobody is now taking the pain of maintaining the hardware, okay, come up with fixes if some hardware part fails, and in, again installing the software, the operating system, and then Hadoop, Hive, and whatever bunch of the zoo of products they have, and then have a person monitor it, maintain it. So nobody wants to take that pain now. Okay, so now the concept is all about service oriented, or I would say IT is getting consumerized, so that a single person or a consumer can even leverage some of the services of cloud. So the world has come to that point. So in reality, what is happening is nobody now is freshly. So we have big implementations of Apache Hadoop. There is no doubt about it. And there are old implementations and they are still doing fine. But now what companies and orgs are thinking is they are not spending that effort in learning Hadoop, train a set of persons to learn Hadoop, then install Hadoop, then install Hive, install Pig, or whatever the supporting projects you want. So that takes a lot of effort in terms of human resource deployment and time. So the concept is there are certain companies who are bundling all these projects together. Okay, I'm just giving a background before showing the demo. It should help you guys. So what companies are doing are, so this is the real life picture I'm giving you. They are bundling Hadoop, Hive, or whatever products they identify are really useful for a entire data analytics platform. So they are bundling it and they are giving it as a single software installer to companies. So you just double click the installer, it gets set, you just provide the node names and things like that. It gets installed automatically. It gets configured automatically. Hive and every supporting project, they get configured automatically. So that becomes hell lot easier for other people, right? Who just want to use, who are looking from a solution oriented perspective. So you don't need to take that headache of installing and managing the entire piece. So that's where the world is focusing to. Okay, so you have already heard about Cloudera. They have the biggest share at present in big data and Hadoop implementations. So Cloudera CDH, Cloudera Hadoop is one such earliest, one of the earliest ones to come out in the market. And they have really a big hold presently in the industry. We have somebody called Greenplum. They also have their parallel computing and Hadoop implementations that are again bundled. So for example, they will bundle certain products, Hadoop, Hive, Pig, Scoop, Flume. That's all. You take it. You want something else, they will plug it in. So that's the way it works. So Cloudera was the pioneer, Greenplum. We have Hortonworks. And now we have Microsoft coming into the picture. Okay, even I'm just not naming IBM and Google. They all have their cloud and big data computing platforms. Google was the pioneer, as if you remember Sunil mentioned in one of the initial talks. So coming back, so these guys are all doing the same thing. They are bundling Hadoop and all the products and they're giving it for easy installation and configuration. Now what Hortonworks started doing different is they started making this bundle or this distribution or this installer of Hadoop and its supporting products, they started making it compatible across different operating systems. Okay, the other guys, they focused. So Hadoop traditionally was developed on Linux, okay, and Unix, so Java based. So all the other distributions or all the other guys, they built on that core framework only. What Hortonworks tried different is they tried building Hadoop for, you know, different flavors of Linux sometimes, and even for Windows and Mac machines. So they were the first one to make those changes in the open source project so that it runs on Windows also. So guys who are familiar with Unix, you will know shell script, right? You will know daemons, but in Windows world they don't exist. So what exists in Windows world is like batch files .bat or .cmd .command files. So all the shell scripts were translated to command files, to batch files. Okay, all the daemons, when they come to the Windows world, they become services when we see in the services console in Windows. Okay, so these translations were done by Hortonworks and they started making it available for Windows because there is a big enterprise user base for Windows operating system as well. Okay, so normally you see these open source systems running on universities and colleges because they are free, but where there is high availability or where there is critical situation support required, you will find a lot of Microsoft implementations as well. Okay, so that instantly became a hit. People on Microsoft technologies, they started to grab on Hadoop, and they could do it easily. They don't have to take the pain anymore to learn Java, to learn Unix and Linux and all those stuff. They can do it on Windows. So that's the part different that they did. Now, then what happened is Microsoft has also seen this picture that the industry is coming to that point where people are using bundled products. So they also bundled, and since Hortonworks had done like 90% of the job of Hadoop running on Windows, Microsoft just joined hands with Hortonworks, okay? And so we at the same time cannot be a partner with Hortonworks and cannot be a competitor, right? Because if we are also selling Hadoop on Windows, and if they are also selling Hadoop on Windows, so we become competitors. And when we are partnering, we don't want to be that. So what we did was, we didn't have any releases for Windows server based Hadoop distribution. So what Microsoft released was the cloud based service. Okay, so that's the specific implementation that Microsoft has. So it's a Azure or Microsoft cloud based service that we deploy or that we provide for users. So what it does essentially is, people who are familiar with Azure will know that it's like a bunch of services. It could be a SQL service, SQL Server database service. So the advantage of Azure is again moving to the cloud, correct? So you don't want to take the hazard of buying your own hardware, maintaining it, installing the software, the OS and everything, think about the licensing part, and then again upgrade to different versions, apply all security patches, and there are a whole lot of things that needs to be taken care of in while you maintain an infrastructure of systems, right? So people want to avoid it. So what we will do is, whenever you request for a Hadoop cluster in Azure in Microsoft, what you do essentially get is a cloud service. So what it does is it provisions, so you choose how many nodes you want in your cluster, so it will create that many virtual machines in the cloud, and then install Hadoop and Hive. So Microsoft has its own packaging of the projects, correct? As I said, Hadoop is not alone, right? It's an entire zoo of products. So it's very important which ones you give preference and include in your distribution. So even if Microsoft and Hortonworks are partnering, there are differences in their implementations, okay? So the ones that Hortonworks ships in Windows Server environments, in the Azure-based service, we ship different. Again, I'll request guys to keep the questions for later. We can have a look at it. Okay. So this is the entire picture. So when you go out in a conference like GIDS that I went yesterday, so it was for professionals, right? So you pay and come into the conference. So you cannot just give them basic knowledge, and you can just cannot show them, you know, what is Hadoop. And everybody knows, whoever came yesterday, they all know what is Hadoop. They all know how it works. Say all you have to, the picture that you have to give is how the world is seeing towards it and how the world is approaching it. Okay, so yes, whatever questions you have, please have a note of it. Okay, we are recording it, so I just don't want to waste time. So we'll go ahead. Once we complete it, you come back to your note, you see the questions, and you go ahead and ask me. Okay, thank you. So coming back to the actual demo. So social media, personally, I think social media is something that is going to rule in the next 2 to 5 years. Guys, please be on mute. Oh my God. Man, this is a pain. You know, I have to find who is speaking here, and then I have to mute. So I really wish I had an assistant. Anyways, so that's going to be the next big thing. If you see, every device, everything these days is integrated with social media. And I don't understand what makes people go there and personally, you know, and pour their personal data, pictures, comments, thoughts, or whatever. I don't know what makes them put every day in there, but it's happening. I can see that. So whenever a new movie comes or whenever a new product comes, I could see that people say how is it or what is it like in social media, okay, in terms of picture, in terms of posts, comments, tweets, whatever. So industries have now understood that they cannot just ignore social media. A lot of people are there. Okay, when we talk of Twitter, we speak about billion users in the world. So you cannot just ignore what they are saying. Correct. So that has become very important. New subjects have been created around social media. I mean, the world never knew that people want to be so much social every day. So I am very much into it. So the one good thing apart from everything else is like if you establish yourself as a social media guy, you can, you know, open Facebook, Twitter in your office and wherever. So nobody is like going to raise their eyebrows. So that's one great thing about it. So I personally do that and take advantage of it. So jokes apart. So it's enterprises may analyze sentiment about certain things. Okay. It could be a product, service, about your competitors and about your goodwill. Okay. This keeps on blinking, man. Okay, so it could be a service, competitor, or goodwill of your company. So, for example, we did certain analysis when Windows 8 came out. Okay, how people are speaking about it or how they're reacting to it. So, these are the things you can know. You can determine exactly what people think about your product or how positive or negative they are based on geographical locations. Okay, so culture matters. Different countries, different culture. So, something that you may put up, it might be accepted very in a great way in a certain culture, but it won't be accepted in that very manner in another culture. It can happen. So geographical location, age, demographics. So these are very important to analyze what you want to know. Okay. And again, some future prediction, what would people prefer to see? Okay. Or what changes they want. So these are the things that you can determine. Right. And again, I'm working on a solution. That will be like a full-fledged social media analytic engine or a parser kind of a thing with different social media channels integrated and that. So that's a complete solution, right? For a demo, what we will see that what are the basic steps. So again, I'm going to share this obviously like I do. So this will be a building block for you where you can build upon, okay, the way you want. So there's a difference between a demo and a full-fledged solution, right? So the basic steps that you need to do and note that in this small demo, I don't have all these steps implemented, but ideally it should be something like that. I have a glimpse on all of these aspects. Okay. So the first thing is filtering. You need to remove noise from your data, right? You need to remove noise from your data. I have given some examples, like you can identify usernames and sometimes maybe URLs and stuff like that. The next part, which is very important. So all of them are very important. So according to sequence, it's tokenization. So you need to break your tweets because these are not like Boolean values, yes or no or one or zero, right? So these will be free flowing text. And that's why it is ideally suited. It's semi-structured data. It's ideally suited for big data platforms because in SQL Server there is something called full text search, but still it is limited. So you it's difficult to search or it's difficult to scan through text which is freely flowing. It doesn't have a pattern. So tokenization is very important. You need to split that stream of words into certain tokens which we will process. Okay, and again, yeah, it says you can split with some logic using commas and or different punctuations, right? The next is removing the stop words. So there are certain words you need to like, yeah, you can see the examples, right? So you can remove they do not make like add to the value when you actually mine the tweet. And the last part is constructing n-grams. Okay, so our solution is based on unigram, but it can go up to the level of n-gram. So when I say n-gram, so gram is a term used for data processing. Okay, and you can think about it as a unit. Okay, so you can form. So how do you determine the sentiment, right? How do you do that? So for that you have to, it's very it comes spontaneously that you need to have some repository where you have a classification of good and bad, correct? Where you will do the lookup. Now things become really difficult a person can tweet anything, right? He can be sarcastic in his tweets as well. It's not that it will be straightforward every time and you can just do a lookup and determine. So he can be sarcastic. So when tweets like that become like makes it more tricky. Okay, when you are sarcastic, you cannot just you might not be able to determine the correct sentiment according to the tokens that you have formed. Correct. So what you may need to do is you need to group many more words and then do an analysis on those words to get a sense. And again, for handling sarcasm and all, you have to have a processing engine that gets smarter with time. That's very important. So for SQL Server world, you can use the classifier algorithm that works the best, and you need to train your classifier. Okay, so just a glimpse. So the n-grams and all, they come as a part of those. So you can see as a negation, okay, a false positive. So these things you can take care using n-grams. So Hive, so coming back to Hadoop, Hive has native functions for n-grams and unigrams and bigrams. So you can go ahead and have a look at that. Okay, all right. So next, moving forward. Yes, so what we do in this demo, okay? So as you will see, I'll show you the tweets when we stream it in. It's very raw. I mean, it doesn't have a structure. I mean, it has a structure. There's nothing unstructured. Everything has a structure. Some are well-structured, some are not well-structured, some are semi-structured and things like that, right? Everybody has a structure. There is nothing called unstructured. We convert that JSON. So specifically speaking, it's a JavaScript object notation data type. Okay, it's a JSON object that comes when you use the Twitter APIs to stream in the tweets. So you convert that tweet in a tabular format. So what specifically I mean by tabular format is you give it some meaning. You provide it a schema. Okay, and that's the magic of Hive I like about it. Okay, so what happens in traditional world, what I've seen in SQL Server is you create the schema, which is pretty rigid. It has referential integrity. It has like n types of integrities, and the schema is very rigid. You cannot just insert data however you like. And after creating the schema, you load the data into the schema. So that's the thing that how it works in SQL Server. In Hive, it's the other way around. Okay. It sounds weird, but it's the other way around. So you have the data already in your Hadoop storage or HDFS. You can use Hive to provide a schema to that data. Okay, you already have the data. You can provide a schema to that data. So that schema can be flexible. On the same data, you can use multiple schemas and see multiple structures of the table. I hope it makes sense. If it doesn't, go back and read about the basics of Hive, so that will help you. So that's the beauty of Hive. So that's the first step. We do it. We convert into a tabular. We schematize the data. We then use a dictionary file to score the sentiment of each tweet. So we will have a dictionary, or we will have a lexicon, to be specific, where we have the words and we have the polarity of each word. So we'll look up to that dictionary. We will assign a score, and then we will create some staging tables to store the data in Hive, and then we'll use Power BI, or we'll use the Microsoft Self-Service BI in Excel to see a nice visualization real quick. Okay, so that's pretty much it. We can jump to the demo. Okay, everybody looks on mute, so that's good. All right, so the first step is to ingest the data, okay? Couple of things. I've talked about Microsoft's implementation on Windows. It's an Azure service. So I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Azure. I'll just show you a glimpse. I'm not going to talk about Azure, so don't be afraid. So this is the Microsoft Azure portal, okay? And it has all different kind of services that I can take. I can create virtual machines and use it as my desktop and things like that, okay? So the Hadoop service comes here. I hope you guys can see it's HD Insight, and you can see I have a lot of clusters running because I've been giving demos and I have a lot of clusters. So these are all Hadoop clusters, okay, in the cloud. So if I click on any of them, it will show me the details, right? It says data node count is 2, so it's a 2 node cluster, okay? And I have a head node as usual. So it's saying how many cores I have. It will show me the activities also. I do not have much activities. I guess in this guy I'll have some activities. Okay, forget it. So this is the Azure portal, and you have different things. One is HD Insight, you have SQL databases, you have many things, okay? You can have Visual Studio and things like that. So this is the Azure portal, and what you can do is you can remote, you can RDP into any of these VMs. So these are all VMs in the Azure. So you can do enable remote, and you can RDP, and you can see the Hadoop portals that you are used to. So they are basically Hadoop, just deployed in Windows in cloud. So one thing we understand that it's not possible for everyone to test it out, even if they want it to learn, because this comes with some cost, right? Even if a minimum of Azure subscription you need to have. So that's not possible, or that's not feasible for everybody who are learning or who are looking to evaluate. So what we have is we have an emulator for the same cloud service to install in your local machine. It's freely available. So it's the same software bits. The only thing is it's a one node. So for learning, you really don't need multiple nodes. Just like to learn some specific like replication and things like that, you may need. But for basic learning, you don't need multiple nodes, really. So we have a one node emulator, and that one node can be tweaked. Some hacks you can do in the configuration, and you can make it multi-node. But let's not get into that. So if you see, in my local machine, I have this. So this is the Hadoop name node portal, right? It says live nodes one. The only difference is it's running on Windows. It's running on Windows. You already see I have some data. If I browse the file system, I'll see I have some data. Okay. Some data here I have. And even for the yesterday's presentation, I had some data. So if you see, these are router logs. Typically, that doesn't make any sense unless and until you schematize the data. So I have this guy up and running. So Hadoop is running on my Windows. And I have the Hadoop command prompt also. So the command-based console. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll launch Hive. I hope you guys can see. So I'll launch Hive, and I guess I have the tables here. So I already have some tables. So what I'll go do is I'll go ahead and drop the tables. Okay, so that it becomes okay. I have some errors, and I know what that error is. Okay. Okay. Let me get rid of this guy. Yeah. So this looks clean. Forget about the router logs. That's the part of a different demo. Apart from that, I have two tables, dictionary and time zone map. These are pre-created, so I'll show you later. So first, let's see how to ingest, okay? So what I used is a .NET program. Ideally, if you are talking about Hadoop framework, there is something called Flume. That is specifically, that is a project like Hive, Pig and all. That's a separate project. And that's specifically built for ingestion, data ingestion into your Hadoop storage. So ideally, you should use Flume in a fully fledged solution. Here for this demo, I'm just using a .NET client to a console-based client to consume the Twitter APIs and do it. So it's a, you see the, it's an app that I have to create in Twitter and I have to authorize the app. So it's a two-way authorization that works. So the application comes back and it gives me another validation URL. And I have to authorize it back. Okay, so this means that it has started streaming the tweets. Okay, right now it's hard coded to C drive in a file called output, and these are the small things you can change. Okay, you see this guy, 0 KB. So yeah, again I said when you are collecting data, you need to focus on something, right? On a certain brand or certain movie, certain product. So for this demo, what I chose is, like, which is very popular. A lot of people are tweeting about it because it captures live tweets. Okay, right now from when I launched the application from that time. So what I've done is it's growing. So I've captured tweets with the hashtag of Pepsi IPL. I'm sure a lot of people, all India is. So whatever tweet has Pepsi IPL, it will stream. Okay, every tweet has Pepsi IPL for sure. So it will start streaming, and if I move back and forth, I will see that, see, it's updating. So as people are tweeting, okay, somebody decided to unmute. Okay, so as I shift focus, so as the people are tweeting, the tweets are the it's getting here. So what I'll do is, so I tweeted, okay? See, it has come, right? You can see it. If you see, so Debarchanes is my handle. You will see Debarchanes somewhere. So the whole point is, so it's streaming the live tweets, and let me just go ahead and delete this. All right. So now if you see, oh, come on. So now if you see, we need to let it run for a while to grab. We don't have the time right now. So for example, if you run it for maybe 1 hour, it will collect 9-10 MBs of data because it's plain text. Even 10 MB of text is the key here is the variety or the unstructured or the semi-structuredness of the data, right? You see, it's a plain JSON. It doesn't make sense. You can understand this is the text, but the other columns, it doesn't make sense. But there is a lot of information in there, okay, in terms of retweets or hashtags, a lot of information that you can extract out of the data. And what we are going to do is exactly that, okay? But for this demo, I won't use this file. I'll close it because it will take some time to generate. What I'll use is one file that I ran, or the tweet that I collected for around an hour. Okay, this is the raw tweets, and this I did for it a while back for the movie RoboCop. Okay, that time it was pretty resonating. So even that time during collecting this file, I have tweeted. So if I find, I'll see I have tweeted, okay? And if I go in the beginning, I'll see I have tweeted it was great and things like that. I have multiple tweets. So in some of the tweets, I have even said that it was not that good. Okay. So I said watching RoboCop, which is neither good nor bad. So I have a few tweets around that, and I have extracted those tweets and summed it up here. So these were my tweets, two good, two bad, and one kind of neutral. Okay. So what I have done is I have uploaded this file to my Hadoop file system. So I uploaded this tweet file in my Hadoop file system. Who is this guy? So if I go to the NameNode portal in my HDFS, I see there is a directory where I already uploaded this text that I collected for 1 hour. If I go into it, the data is familiar, right? It's a similar data that we saw in that file. So it's that same data. Okay? And it has somewhere it has my tweets. Okay? The raw tweets. And two more things I have, if you notice here. One is a dictionary and one is a time zone map. Okay? I'll show you the time zone map. I'll come to the dictionary later. So what is the time zone map? So it has the time zone and a map of the country to where that time zone belongs. This is because the end result is going to, we are going to plot it in according to the geographical location. So we'll need the country, and that in the tweets you only get the user's time zone. So that's how you map and extract the country information. Okay, that's my time zone. And let me show you the dictionary as well. So it's a dictionary. It has all the words starting from A to going all the way down, and it has a polarity associated with each word. That's pretty straightforward. There is a position that can be used further for n-gram analysis, but for this Twitter demo, this much is enough. So it has a position, it has the word, it has a context how it is used, and its polarity. So this is the file we are going to look up and compare and determine the sentiment of our tweets. Okay, so let's go back. So now we have the data staged. Okay, we have the raw data, the tweets we have uploaded that we are going to parse. We have the time zone and the dictionary as well. So now what we will do is the first step, as I said, we will provide a schema to the raw tweets, and for that we will use this script. This guy, okay? So I'm creating a table. So I like Hive because it's very familiar with SQL. So you can write Hive query languages, where they are very similar to SQL query languages. So I can create a table, and you remember in that raw tweets we had so many columns, but this schema is not that big. So you only schematize the part we only need. So somebody else can create another table with some other columns. So that's what you can, the schema is flexible. You can provide different schema on top of the same data. So I'm taking the ID. So every tweet has an ID, right? So that's the unique identifier, the primary key, so that you can uniquely identify that tweet. So it's taking the ID, it's creating, taking the time, and it's taking so much information and creating a schema. Couple of things to note is the location. So this is the location you remember here, from where it will pick up tweets raw, where it will pick up the file to schematize on. And there is a SERDE. So what I mean by SERDE? A SERDE is a serializer deserializer. So when you do operations like MapReduce on your data needs to be serialized from your memory to your disk and vice versa, right? So since the tweets are coming in JSON format, we have a specific JSON serializer deserializer. So you have to use it. It's freely available. Okay, it can be downloaded. So the row format used in that table will be JSON SERDE. If you don't want to use a custom SERDE, Hive has an inbuilt function called get JSON object. You can use that to get to serialize your JSON part. Okay, but this is something ready-made, less effort needed. Okay, So I'll copy this and I'll run this guy in my command prompt. Okay. So it says time taken 9.91. So it provided the schema. See how fast is it is, right? Because we already have the data. And now we do a select star from the table that we just created, and we'll do a limit 100 because there are so many rows. So you see, it's the raw tweet that we have, the exactly the way that we saw. It just now has a schema on top of it. Okay, next step. So just like I schematized this file, I have done it for the dictionary. So you saw the dictionary file. These were the columns in that file, and I just created a table so that I can do joins and stuff like that. So that's a, as mentioned, one-time process. You don't need to do it every time. So I have already done that. Okay, I've already done that, and I've created the dictionary and the time zone map files. I've created the dictionary and the time zone map files. If you see here, I already have the dictionary. I'm sorry, if you see here in Hive, when I did a show tables. Sorry. We already had the dictionary and the time zone map. Tweet raw is the one that has come up new, just the one that we schematized now. Okay, so we will skip these two guys. Now we will do some cleanup operations. Okay, filtering. So for this specific format, the time we are formatting the time. Okay, just for an example to show how filtering can be done in the intermediate steps. So we are doing a lot of nested function calls. Okay, lot of nested function calls on the actual data that came as timestamp. Okay, we created a field called timestamp, if you remember. Okay, I cannot find it. Anyways, so if you see, I have a file to explain how it actually looks like when it processes. Okay. Yes, this guy. So the raw data, when we got the raw tweet, the time format was like this. Okay, that's your tweeter's JSON time. And after applying all the, so first we apply substring, then we do concatenate. If you see the script, you see, right? First we apply substring, then we do concatenate. So things like that. So after substring, it becomes this. After concatenation, it becomes this. Then we convert it to Unix time. It's a number. It becomes this. And then we cast it as timestamp finally. So the final output is this. So that's a bit of formatting that we are doing. All right? Not a big deal. I'll run this guy and create another view called tweet simple. Okay? Done. So if I do a show tables, I'll see one additional guy, tweet simple view popping up. Okay. Next is the time zone join part when we get the country. So if you see, I am selecting, we are creating a new view again, clean. We are getting the tweet ID, the timestamp, the text, the actual tweet content, and then m dot country. This m is an alias for time zone map. So we are joining, we're doing a left outer join. Everything there on the time zone, and you map it with this and get me the country from the time zone table. Okay, so this is how we get the country information in this view. Let's go ahead and create this. All right, done. Next is the part that is tricky, where we actually assign some sentiment. What we do is we create three levels. Okay, and what we do is, this text is the actual content, remember, the tweet content. So we flatten this text in different sentences. So a tweet can have multiple sentences. So now the tokenization part comes into picture. We need to break down into multiple tokens or chunks. So we use some inbuilt functions of Hive like explode and sentences, okay, so that we split the tweets. If it is spanning multiple sentences, we will split the tweet and get the individual sentences. For this demo, to answer this question, so somebody has a question about natural language processing or NLP. To answer the question, this is a very basic demo. And again, the motive of this group is to start from the very basics. So NLP, I do not consider something to be really basic. So in the actual solution that I'm working on, yes, there is no choice but to use NLP, and I'm using that. But for this demo, I try to keep it very simple. Okay, so. I'll go ahead and create this guy. Actually, I'll just run all three of these. So I create three views, L1, L2, L3. I'll explain what these levels are in a while. Okay, so these three got created. So I have another file that explains what is L2, L3 and L3. So the raw tweet was like this, where every ID was unique. Forget about the junk data that you see, okay? So every ID is unique and it can have multiple sentences separated by full stop and stuff like that. After L1, what it does is we explode it according to the sentences, okay? So that means a tweet ID can be repeatable here. It's repeating. So it has now segregated it according to the sentence. If a tweet has multiple sentences, it will have two rows for each tweet. Or if it has three sentences, it will have three rows for a single tweet. This is L1. Then we do L2. For example, take this guy. We are now breaking. So see, all this is a single tweet, the single ID. So we are now breaking the tweet into it from individual sentences to individual words. You are breaking it. And how we are doing it? We are using the same explode function. So now, firstly, we exploded the sentences. Then we, from L1, we explode the words as a single word. Okay, so it's a single word that we come down to here. And then in L3, let me explain what we are doing first. In L3, what we are doing, we are creating a view called L3. We are taking ID and the word, the individual word from L2 that I just created, and then I'm doing a join with dictionary, where L2.word is D.word, and I'm getting the polarity information. And we are getting the polarity information. If you remember the dictionary table, it had polarity. So we are getting that D.polarity. And when that word join equals to -1, I'm saying negative, positive, and neutral. So there, this is actually creating the compute. Okay. So this is how these three views are getting created. So after L3, you will see a value like this. For individual words watching Robocop, it has assigned 0 because none of them determine any positive or negative sentiments. Okay, none of the words. If you now consider my tweet which said Robocop was awesome, there will be a word awesome and it will have 1 beside it. So that's how it assigns the sentiment for each words. Okay. Now, the next step. The next step will take some time because it actually fires a MapReduce job, right? So I'll just run the statement first and then explain. So now if we do a show tables, we'll see L1, L2, L3 all got created, and we'll try creating the new table called tweets sentiment. As you can see, it starts launching MapReduce. Okay, so there are some aggregations that we are doing and that invokes. So it's the job number 13, if you see here. So I have run multiple MapReduce jobs in this local cluster. So it's the 13th. Ideally, if it's a new installation, so again, this emulator is freely installable. It's available. So you can run the entire demo as it is in your local machine for testing and learning, things like that. And that's specifically on Hadoop on Windows. So if you see, it's firing the MapReduce jobs for stage 1. Note that it has multiple stages. If I go to the query, what I'm now doing is, so now if you remember, with every level I have, for individual tweets, I have a word and an individual score assigned to it. Now I have to aggregate it back to get the sentiment of the entire tweet, right? So I have to add it up. So what I'm doing is, it's very simple. When I'm doing a sum of the polarity, it's either -1, 1 or 0. And we are summing up all the word scores. And the aggregate, if it's greater than 0, then we are thinking it is positive. It is less than 0, it's negative. Else we are getting it as neutral. So there are two aggregations that we are doing. So that's why there are two stages in your MapReduce job. Okay, it must be still running. Yes, okay, it's done. So if you go to your, so that was job number 13. Okay, so if you go to your MapReduce portal, you will just see these guys. So there are two jobs actually that fired, you know, April 26, 11:54. It's about the time now. Two jobs fired. So it's pretty much similar to your traditional Hadoop. So you can see the details of the jobs and the counters and everything. Okay. So now we have a table called tweet sentiment with positive negative assigned. Now there's a last step. So again, that's pretty much, that might not be needed, but I have done it because that's the ritual, I would say, in every BI visualization part, where you are looking to plot some data in a graph or in a map, the numerical values are always helpful. Okay, negative, it's easier to put a graph on 1, 0 and minus 1 rather than on something like negative, positive. And so what we are doing is we are just renumbering it and taking it back, and we are exposing it into a final table called Tweets BI. Remember, this table will be consumed by front-end applications like Excel or any other BI tool, and that will show the visualization on the data. Okay, so I'll just go ahead and create this table. So again, some MapReduce jobs, because there's a case statement, it has to again aggregate and assign the values actually. So now if I go back to the portal, I should be seeing one job that is running. Here it is. Yeah, so this guy has started. So this guy has started. We'll see map. There are two map tasks because of the case. So it's pretty much the same that you see. So I'll not spend too much time on it. And it's still running. While it is running, I'll show you something, which is the bridge, okay, between your Hadoop, your file system, Hive, whatever tables I have. So there needs to be a bridge that will connect this guy, this Hadoop, these Hive tables, to somebody like Excel, or to someone like a reporting services, or to someone like a Tableau, okay, where you will visualize the data. So every Hadoop distribution, be it Hortonworks, be it Cloudera, whoever it is, even Microsoft, they will, along with their bundle of Hadoop, they will also give a ODBC driver, okay, so which is compatible with any ODBC client. That's a pretty standard, and that can consume data from your Hadoop, Hive, and it can be connected from Excel, BIN, and any ODBC compliant tools. Okay, so that's called the Microsoft Hive ODBC driver. So if I go to ODBC AD32 or the ODBC driver manager, I'll see a driver called Microsoft Hive ODBC driver, which I can use to connect to these Hive tables from Excel or any tool. Okay, so now this guy has completed. I'll do a show tables. Okay, and I'll see all the tables are ready. Tweets BI, remember, is my final table. Now coming back to this guy, so I had some sample tweets, right? Two was good, two was bad, and one was neutral. So according to the logic that we applied, we should see. So I have got hold of these IDs of my tweets. So if we query something like this with my tweet handles, then we should get an output. According to our logic that we applied, we should get an output something like this, where the first two good ones will be one, the negative ones will be minus one, and watching Robocop should be zero. So let's just confirm it by running this query. Somebody has decided. Yeah, got it. So you see, yeah, it comes up with that same data. Okay, so now is the part. So this data is of no use until and unless you have a visualization on it. Okay, people need to see it, your top management. Okay, so what you can do is you can quickly do something in Excel. So I launch Excel. So okay, one more thing to show is now you have to create a DSN. Okay, that connects. So I already have one. You can do it for Azure. As I said, these two are like the same bits and they go side by side. Whatever you can do on Azure, you can do it here. I encourage using the emulator because it's your test bed, free of cost. And once your solution is done, you can then port it to Azure and take the cost. So I have it for emulator. I see localhost. This is the Hive port where the Hive server listens. And that's pretty much it. You can test. It should succeed. Alright, so I already have this DSN that I can use from my Excel. So I create a blank workbook and I go to data from Microsoft Query, and I can see these DSNs. Okay, the DSNs are listed. So I choose the emulator and let's give it a while to connect. So if you see it enumerates all the tables and views that we just created, right? And we are interested on only this tweets BI and only the country part, because we are going to project it geographically. We don't need the ID. Okay, I do a next, 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 and finish. It will take some time to bring the data back. Yes, I want this data in this existing worksheet. And see, it says waiting for the query to be executed at the bottom of the Excel pane. So it's firing a remote Hive query, the same queries that we firing from the command prompt. It's firing through the ODBC driver and getting the data that we have in Tweets BI right here. Okay, so we have the country and the sentiment. I'll just remove the blanks here. Okay. And I'll insert a Power View. So Power View is again one of the Microsoft Power BI products where you can really design reports or visualizations very quickly. Okay, so I'll open Power BI. I'm sorry, the Power View. So these kind of solutions, they need very strong computer, okay? They're all in-memory operations. So it's ideal you have a 64-bit computer, 64-bit office, and at least I don't want to say 8. I should say 16 gigs of RAM, maybe, if you are dealing with GBs and terabytes of data. If you are like below within GB or the gigabyte scale, I guess 8 GB machine would be good enough. Oh, it's taking forever. Oh my God. I'll just give it 2 seconds because these are indeed memory intensive operations, so sometimes it can get stuck. On man. I'll just give it a try again, okay, guys? Sorry for that, bear with me, please. See, this guy has grown to 800 kV in this entire time, almost close to 1 hour. Yeah, a lot of tweets on IPL, huh? If groomed properly, Umesh Yadav can easily be one of the fastest on the planet. Really? Okay. I don't know what's happened here, but okay, this part will come, I know. The problem happened the last time with the power query. So let me just do not do any filtering and insert a power view. I think it crashed again, man. Seriously, let me actually have a saved copy of this guy. I'm not sure if there's a problem with power view suddenly, otherwise nothing will open. So once you the power view is loaded, it should load a screen like this, okay, where it plots the data according to sentiment. So what we can do is we have added a color. We can we color is added for the sentiments, and we have the circles that you see. The size of it depends on the count of sentiment. So how many people have tweeted? So easily we can see about that this movie RoboCop. North America is the one who's like America. America is the one who spoke more about it, United States. Out of them, negative, it shows, right? Negative was minus one. All right? Positive was 206, and 635 people were neutral. Again, this is a very basic framework for judging this analysis. So as somebody said, NLP is an engram is the next level to take it there, which I'm trying to do. But maybe I'll not be able to share it, because once I'm able to complete it, I'll give it to somewhere else, which could be non-disclosable. So this is how quickly we can generate the report. So I really don't lose hope so easily. So what I'll do is I'll just give up one. So see, this is the data that we got. Okay. Like the files that crashed a couple of times. So this was where we were, right? So we got the countries and the data, and we just go to insert and we do a power view. I'll do it again. Create a power view sheet. See, this time it opened. Okay. See, this time it opened. I don't know what that was problem with this file. So I'll just show you how to do it. So when the power view opens, it comes like this. You have the country and you have the sentiment score. You can just pop it out if you want. Country and the sentiment score. All right. Now what I do, I simply click on this map and it loads the map. It plots, correct? According to the number of tweets and the sentiments. We don't see the colors. So what we do is we go to sentiment here in the right side and say add as color. So then it puts the color on my sentiments, correct? And then what I do is I do a count, a distinct count of the data. So there's something wrong with this, it looks like, but this is how you actually generate the power view. So this is one of the dimensions of analysis that you can do. You can do much more. Okay, let me show you another file which I took around like a couple of hours to design, because this visualization, you need to know what you want to see out of that data, correct? So go to the first one. So this is a sheet that I have created time categories. So if the time is this, I determine it as midnight, this is morning, afternoon, things like that. So I do a Twitter analysis. Okay, it's coming up. So I can do like this. How much was the count for the tweets on that specific keyword for a certain period of time? Then I can visualize what was that part of the day when it was tweeted. And we can sum the negative, positive, and neutrality also. Okay, people doing it in the early morning, are really pissed off about it. So they are tweeting bad. So these are the things we can do, okay? And we just capture other hashtags like big data, SQL, and things just to see how they go. All right, we can plot the coordinates. So that's something that I just showed you how to do. It's just a formal version or a refined version, I should say, of the same analysis that I just showed. How do you get the sentiment and what were they tweeting about and what is the part of the country they are interested, okay? According to colors, you all see legends here, red, negative, green, positive, and stuff like that, right? And last but not least, we can do a sentiment analysis over time, okay? So you see, this is the count of tweet, and you can see, again, this is the count of tweet, the area of the circles determine the number of tweets. These are the fields from which we are getting the details, okay? And this is how they are talked about. So I can play this timeline to show an interactive report like this. And we can see that big data is, if you run it again, big data was pretty low when people were tweeting, but suddenly it is picking up and it's actually surpassing SQL at the end. So we collected for 4 or 5 years, okay? So these are the interesting analysis that you can get out of it. All right. So yes, I guess that was pretty much it. The customary slide that I have to get in touch with me. And yes, as again I do every time, I'll upload the entire recording to your YouTube channel, right? So that's all, guys. Thanks for joining, and I'll just stop the recording and leave some time for you guys to